The Huascas lived along the Columbia River, actually on both sides. In our culture, we've had Huascas for so many generations, you know, we just can't count them. In this area, they were used primarily for the powdered salmon to trade. They were used to collect different kind of root crops. They were used to store the plants in. When we traded, say, the roots or the salmon, we traded them container and all. So that meant we'd always have to be making baskets, which is a good thing because that's how we preserve our knowledge. When the Euro-Americans were coming in, at that time it was, America was agrarian. So what the immigrants wanted was the land. So we were moved from our traditional lands to reservations. And the reservation we were moved to was south of our traditional lands in Warm Springs. And so we were literally rounded up. I would say for two, almost three generations, we lost a lot of our culture. And it wasn't just at Warm Springs. It was the same experience with a lot of reservations in this area in the Northwest. That was another good reason for me to pick up basket weaving and give workshops and make sure that this doesn't die out again. I had always seen pictures of the basket that's in the Peabody Museum, and I knew this design is very intricate, but it was also a very beautiful design, and almost all the pictures I've seen of it show the side with the column of dogs, but I was interested in how the faces were and how the faces were intricately connected with the geometric outside. So when I went back to the Peabody, there were a number of items I wanted to see, but mainly the basket. So they had the basket out. I held it like I would a baby. I just held it real close to me because it was so special that I had to hold it near my heart. And it was almost as if the basket was communicating with me when I was holding it. And it just had a nice warmth, a nice feeling to it. So I was looking at all of these different faces, realizing that it was based on the petroglyphs around Nicloidy. And the petroglyphs were done, obviously, by different people. So all of these were expressing different people, a whole community of Huasco people, but they were all individuals. And then the other thing that came through to me was when I looked at this basket in the magazine, I saw a petroglyph face and I saw a geometric image. But when I was holding this, not only did this basket tell me that these were my ancestors, each face was my ancestor, but this image is actually a fishing net. And I'm not far along in this design, but this net, this geometric image is connected around all the faces. And I thought, wow, this is a powerful basket. This is really telling me a lot. So all of this was actually coming to me from the basket. I don't think I would have figured all that out by just looking at it. I had to hold the basket and feel it. And so it's just really a wonderful experience. And then on my baskets, I want to just express myself. This is who I am. This is what I'm doing now. This basket is based on the basket in the Peabody collection. I wanted to put my own variations in. So when I first started this basket, I thought, it's a whole series of faces. So I want to do variations of the faces so it wouldn't be boring for me to repeat the same image over and over again. I like to do smiling faces, or I change the hairdo. And when we're fishing, we usually whistle to get each other's attention, so I always have a face that's whistling. And it's, to me, it's just fun that all the faces, I want to do variations on them. Sometimes I vary this net design. I'll put little images, or I'll put my initials, or I'll put something different in these. And I don't tell anybody I'm doing that. I just, you know, watch the reaction, see if people catch it or if they don't catch it. And the reason I started with Dogbane in the center was the original 1805 basket was started with Dogbane. So I thought, well, I'll do that too. Because I saw this Dogbane growing in this area, that's when I was convinced that a lot of women would come. Historically, they'd come and they would weave in this area. So it must have been easy to get to before the dams were built, before the railroad was put in. So this would be a perfect place to sit and harvest and process Dogbane and just have a good social event as well as getting your work done. There are different weaving techniques, and this particular technique is called full turn twine. So twining is you're twisting two weavers around a warp. So a warp is a spoke, but when I want designs, I'll do a single twist. But that would give me a color I don't want. So then I do a second twist. And that's what makes this basket unique, is I do two twists. You've got to remember that Native people have been in this area for more than 10,000 years. So when you consider our 10,000 years relative to the United States 200 years, there are consequences of having a Euro-American people enter our cultures, because there's been tremendous changes in the past 200 years. So a lot of people look on Lewis and Clark as the Euro-Americans introducing their lifestyle to our culture. Here, some of the tribes are organized and they want to have their voice in the commemoration. And that's how I feel. I think people should be aware that Lewis and Clark would not have been able to make their trip without the Native Americans, that we were here and for generations before any Euro-American ever arrived on this continent. And people should be aware, I think the public should be aware of that.